Let us briefly to revise what was done on the previous lecture, because previous lecture was not translated to other universities properly. So we introduced the symplectic form, which is a key element in definition of the Heisenberg group, and this symplectic form can be given as skew-symmetric expression, which is bilinear in both variables and can be expressed in terms of complex variables as imaginary part of the complex inner product of two vectors. For two dimensions, it's related to a determinant of a matrix, and it's important to note the group which preserves the symplectic form. In two dimensions, this group, which is called symplectic group, is just coinciding with the group of special linear matrices with determinant equal to 1. When we define the non-commutative 2n plus 1 dimensional group, Heisenberg group, which consists of two vectors, which components which called x and y, and a central element of the group S. And when we for this non-commutative Lie group, we note the central part of it, which commutes with the entire group, and the rest. So we are going to investigate that rest in more details. So in particular, it will be useful to have several different forms for our group law presented. And one of them is a complexified form, which use complex vectors x plus iy instead of two real vectors x and y. Another form is called polarized form. It's less symmetric, so somehow symplectic form has more symmetry when we express the group law. However, in this polarized form, certain expression will look simpler later when we will consider them. Also, it will be useful to have a matrix representation for our group. So we are in the case of three-dimensional Lie group, as we called it, H1. So it's three-dimensional manifold. We represent it by 3 times 3 matrices of the expression given in formula 7. When, as for any Lie group, we note the connection with Lie algebra. Better to put it in this way. So connection between Lie groups and Lie algebra so is very fundamental for our practical means. We will use one parameter subgroups, which expressed by exponentiation of corresponding Lie algebra. We also may consider Lie algebra as the tangent space to the group at the group unit. And also, for computational purposes, very convenient to represent Lie algebra by means of first-order vector fields, derivative of the first order with variable coefficients. So all of that formulas will be covered later. And exponentiation is given by the usual Taylor expansion of the exponent function. So whenever we have algebra, so that formula may algebraically have a sense. And if our algebra has a topology, then infinite series can be defined to be convergent for suitable elements x. Here is a presentation of Lie algebra for the Heisenberg group. So exponential map, we will represent it by upper triangular matrices with zeros on the diagonal. And the basis which we will use is given by element SXY, which we have here on the formula 9. Then one parameter subgroups, is just a group homomorphism from the real numbers to with the operation of addition to our Heisenberg group, and this one parameter subgroup can be differentiated with respect to parameter t at any point on the group. It's actually on any point on the group can be differentiated and making a substitution t equal to zero. In this way we will obtain the first order differential operators. Depending which size multiplication we are using, it will be left or right invariant vector fields. And for elements of the Lie algebra, we have the fundamental operation, which known as the commutator. Although it's defined, maybe defined in completely abstract sense as satisfying to a set of properties like be bilinear, antisymmetric, and satisfy to the Jacobi identity, if our Lie algebra has an operation of multiplication, that Lie bracket can be indeed defined as a commutator. So it has the form AB minus BA. In particular, we are able to calculate that commutators for first order differential operators, which was given before. And we will find in particular what for vector fields X and Y, commutator is equal to S. And if we have a more general linear combination of all three elements in the basis, then a commutator is defined by the symplectic form. So symplectic form is just recovered because it's used in the definition of the group operation. It's easy to see from the previous formula, if the commutator of the elements X, Y is equal to S, when S is in the center of the group, and so commuting with the it's commute with everything else. So whenever we build on the Heisenberg group a commutator of third order, a repeated commutator or higher, it will be equal to the zero. So that is expressed in the statement what the Heisenberg group is an nilpotent step to a Lie group. There are nilpotent Lie group of higher nilpotency, so with steps 3, 4, 5 and so on. So Heisenberg group just open that large family, rather important family of Lie groups, and somehow is just a suitable gateway to study that class of the Lie groups. Then if we will express multiplication in term of elements of the Lie group, so if we will take exponentiation A of two elements AB from the Lie algebra, then product of two such elements, as it's given in formula 14, will be simply expressed as A plus B in term of vector operation on the Lie algebra plus half of the commutator of A and B. So that formula is relatively simple, so it's allow us to calculate group multiplication in term of Lie algebra, and essentially as we defined it before, as group law was defined through the symmetric symplectic form, it's given exactly in these exponential coordinates where we identify the Lie algebra and Lie group for the Heisenberg group by means of exponential map. So that formula 14 is really coincide with the defining formula for the Heisenberg group. So formula 4, it's just this expression which we have here. And so what we are using is called exponential coordinates on the Heisenberg group. So formula 14 is very particular special case of rather general so-called Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula. So it's express group multiplication in term of repeated commutators for a generic Lie group that will be an infinite series. For nilpotent Lie groups, with the, commutators of higher order vanish always after a certain degree. So in our case, it's a commutator vanish after the second order commutators. For nilpotently group, Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula is used in polynomial expressions, as in our case. But for other groups, so that may be an infinite series which expresses. So we generally don't need that general result, but it's worth to note a connection with the general theory. Also, a commutator allow us again to decompose the Lie algebra into the direct sum of two components. The one-dimensional component which span the center is generator of the center, so that will be the subspace V0, and the orthogonal complement to V0, that is essentially may be spanned by vectors fields X and Y, and commutator of any vectors from V1 is just belong to the center, to the V0. So that decomposition of the Heisenberg group again is a particular case of a similar decomposition, again longer one, for a nilpotent Lie groups of higher nilpotency as well. So such a more general formula exists. But for us, that decomposition just into term will be rather useful in just a minute. So what our main technique in this course is to use the Heisenberg group in the spirit of Erlangen program of Felix Klein. So we will use certain symmetries which are provided by the Heisenberg group to study numerous objects, different objects, which possess this symmetry of the Heisenberg group. But that approach can be recursively applied to the Heisenberg group itself, and so we may ask what are symmetries of Heisenberg group, so what are group of automorphisms which map Heisenberg group to itself with the preservation of the group law. And there is nice classification of the automorphism of Heisenberg group, which really will again appear and will be helpful for on several occasions later. First of all, our group is non-commutative, and for non-commutative group there is a generic class of automorphism called inner automorphism, and it's given just by a conjugation. So formula 16, whenever you have a non-commutative group, that formula in general provides some non-trivial transformation for your group. So you multiply by element SXY on the left and its inverse on the right. So that obviously preserves the group operation, and explicitly it's given by adding of symplectic form of two elements to the center of the group. So that class of automorphism exists for any group. For non-commutative group it's non-trivial, and so somehow it's of will be later important for us when we will classify irreducible representations of Heisenberg group. Also, because our group law was defined in terms of symplectic form, transformations of components XY which preserve the symplectic form will be automorphism of our group, Heisenberg group. And so in in one-dimensional Heisenberg group, that group of symplectic transformation will be SL2R, as we already mentioned, but for any order of Heisenberg group, there is a corresponding symplectic group which act by such automorphism, symplectic maps on corresponding components. Our group is homogeneous group, that means what there is a group of dilations which preserve the group law, and due to decomposition of the Heisenberg group into center and its orthogonal complement, we need to, and due to commutator structure between these components, so we need to apply different weight to the that decomposition. So xy part of the Heisenberg group, if xy is scaled by a parameter r, then the center of the group s shall be scaled by parameter r squared. So that is a general rule how to get a group automorphism here. For a more general nilpotently group, some of them admit similar group of dilations with different weights on different components of the group. This type of the groups are called homogeneous groups, and some of them may not have such group of dilations. So there are examples. The lowest possible example of nilpotently group which does not admit automorphism by dilation, I think it's something like a 7 or 9 dimensional nilpotently group. And finally, there is an transformation which called inversion. So we just swap order of vectors x and y and simultaneously reverse the direction of the center. Direction of the center is changed to the opposite. So that is easy to check. Again, automorphism of the Heisenberg group. And this is automorphism because the symplectic form is skew symmetric. So swapping order of two elements in the symplectic form produce the corresponding change of sign. So that is just follow from this property of the symplectic form, that automorphism. And as we will see, that last group of symmetry is closely related to the Fourier transform. So first automorphism in this classification is inner. The remaining last three type of automorphisms are known as outer automorphism. And typically outer automorphism, because they are specific to the group, inner automorphism is of generic kind, it exists for any non-commutative group. So outer automorphism are rather special, and they helpful for on many occasions will be helpful to discuss property of the Heisenberg group. All right, what are how to deal with the general automorphism. So the general automorphism of the Heisenberg group will be just a composition of these four classes which we defined before. So and full proof of this result you may find in the following book, Harmonic Analysis on the Phase Space. So here is just a sequence of statements which allow to understand why any automorphism of the Heisenberg group indeed is a composition of four automorphisms discussed before. So first of all, it's easy to verify due to the group law which we expressed in exponential coordinates through the formula 14. So due to this formula 14, we see that any automorphism of the Heisenberg group shall be also automorphism of its Lie algebra. So we may move from automorphism of the group to automorphism of infinitesimal object, Lie algebra. And for the, again, the automorphism of the Heisenberg group, it's clear what it shall respect the decomposition which we introduced in equation 15, just because group law is defined through the commutator, so automorphism shall respect the structure to the Lie algebra which appear from this commutator, so that is decomposition of V0 and V1. We may just to single out the automorphisms which so all that automorphisms will need to send component in this decomposition V0 to itself. So center shall be sent to the to itself, and for resulting linear transformations which are a linear map of the Lie algebra and preserve the center of the group, we have the formula which are given in the end of this slide. So it shall be some linear transformation on the center of xy part and a certain linear combination of x, y and s in the center. And then for such a formula we will get that any only product of these four transformation is possible. So this is just a connection between group structure which we have and the corresponding structure of automorphisms. Now there is a general construction. Whenever you have a group and you have a group of its automorphism, maybe even not full group of automorphism, just some group of automorphism, you may construct a so-called semi-direct product. So probably most natural and known example of the direct product would be so-called AX plus B group. And to start with, we consider the group G to be group of real numbers with addition. So, and then we have a group of automorphisms of this group, which is a group of positive reals with multiplication. So, just distributive law, when we note what we can open bracket in this expression, it tells us what A in the group A provide an automorphism for the group operation on the group G. So two elements B1 and B2 here are thought to be from the group G. So whenever we have group and automorphism acting on that, we may consider a semi-direct product. How it's defined? So when we put an element A, B and A prime, B prime, where A part is from automorphism and B is from the group, then multiplication will be as follow. So we simply multiply two automorphism together, so that is product of A1 A prime, and then A act on the B part of the second element, and we add element B. So this is the group law which appears on semi-direct product for these elements in the that semi-direct product of G and A. So again, if that group law looks to you not very natural, think about the name of this group to be AX plus B. So, and think about corresponding affine transformations of the real line. So if you first apply to a point X the transformation A prime B prime. So it will send point X to A prime X plus B prime, and then to this point you apply a transformation AB. So you multiply everything by A and then apply add B. So exactly what you will obtain will be X plus A B prime B. So you get again a transformation of this type with the group law which was specified before. So this is a generic method to introduce the semidirect product from the group and its automorphism. So in our case we have the Heisenberg group and symplectic group which act by automorphisms. Then we may define the corresponding multiplication on that semidirect product exactly by a formula similar to what we had in the AX plus B group. As you see, on the elements of the group, G and G prime automorphism are just multiplied as A part on the previous example, and automorphism from the second element act on element from the Heisenberg group on the second element. So this is a kind of multiplication which we have. This is very important group which appears in that construction. This is the maximal kinematic invariant group for the quantum harmonic oscillator. It's also the full group of symmetry for heat equation, and we will see what it's connected with the theta function later. So that semidirect product is indeed of big importance. So somehow that semidirect product is also is in between two my major courses. Besides this course on the Heisenberg group, I am reading course about SL to R. So really Schrodinger group appears just as a product of these two my courses on the magic network. Then if we introduced the Heisenberg group, we will be interested in it in the sense of mathematical analysis, and we will use ideology of linear analysis. So we will be interested in linear action of our group, and linear action of our group, we will discuss it in details later, are called linear representations. So we will build a linear representation of the Heisenberg group. They are in importance for the quantum mechanics in particular, and construction which we will use to produce representation of the Heisenberg group is known as induced representation. And for induced representation we will need a discussion of corresponding subgroups and homogeneous spaces of the Heisenberg group. So let us produce a bit of general theory at the beginning. So when that this theory has much bigger application than Heisenberg group itself, so it will be worth to state it in these general terms first. So let we have certain Lie group and we have its closed subgroup. Closed in the topological sense, it's necessary because when we will build a quotient, a homogeneous space G over H, closedness allow us to introduce a topology, respective factor topology, on this homogeneous space. So equivalence relation which we define on the our group is given as follows. So two elements of the group are equivalent if they are different just by a multiplication from the left by a certain element from the subgroup H. It's easy to verify what if this is indeed equivalence relation on the group. So it's symmetric, it's reflexive, and it's transitive. So we may consider corresponding equivalence classes. So we may factorize the group G with respect to this equivalence relation. And of course, whenever we introduce equivalence classes, there is a natural projection which assign every element the corresponding equivalence class to which our elements belong. So this is natural projection. There is no choices here in its definition. And there is certain arbitrariness, there is our choice how to design the right inverse of that map P. So that map P is not one-to-one, so it does not have just inverse or no, full inverse map, but we may invert it from the right in the following sense. What we pick up for every equivalence class, one representative from this class. So for each equivalence class, we pick up one particular element which represents it. So like for a country, we select a president to represent this country. And in most countries, the condition what president need to be a citizen of this country. I think so. That is exactly just equivalence of what we have here. And then it's easy to define an action of our group on these equivalence classes by means of diagram on the equation 80. So we pick up an equivalence class and put it to the group by choosing its representative. So we put element on the group. When we multiply from the left, multiplication from the left will respect equivalence classes defined by the right multiplication on H. So because we multiply on different sides, so by H subgroup we multiply on the right, and here we act by group on the left. So that commuting operation, so equivalence classes are preserved by such left shifts. So we come back to the group, and now because equivalence classes are preserved by left multiplication, we just use the natural projection P coming back to corresponding equivalence class. So in this way, that formula correctly, uniquely define an action for every G which map an equivalence class to some other equivalence class. And we want to classify all homogeneous spaces which appears in this way with corresponding group action. Well, it's clear what if two our group are different. So if we have two groups H and H1 which are different by conjugation, that means exist some element in our group such what H will be G H prime G inverse, then our construction of action of the group and everything here will be just equivalent for these two groups. So we will introduce such equivalence relation, and then corresponding homogeneous spaces with respect to subgroup H and H prime will be equivalent homogeneous spaces with equivalent action. So we are classifying first one-dimensional continuous subgroups for the Heisenberg group, which we can obtain in this way. Then essentially we already seen what where is the center, which is one-dimensional center of the Heisenberg group. This is one-dimensional subgroup, and we also can produce a subgroup which we denote HX. So this is just a parameter T appears on the X place in the Heisenberg group. So clearly there is no an automorphism of the Heisenberg group, neither inner automorphism nor the outer automorphism, which map center to the subgroup HX, just because all automorphism respect the decomposition of the Heisenberg group into center and orthogonal complement. So HX belong to the orthogonal complement of the center. But what we can easily again verify would by means of some group automorphism of the Heisenberg group, any one parameter subgroup of the group Heisenberg group can be transferred or equivalent just to the center of the subgroup HX. And again, here is an illustration why Lie algebras are helpful in the theory of Lie groups. What that statement, that classification of one parameter subgroup, can be based by a classification of the infinitesimal generators, which are elements of the corresponding Lie algebra. Then, for these subgroups, which are not equivalent, we may consider the corresponding homogeneous spaces. So, here there is again certain calculation of dimensions, which can be based on the implicit mapping theorem. So we may see what Heisenberg group, one dimensional as a manifold, has three dimensions. If we factorize with respect to one dimensional subgroup, the respecting manifold will be two dimensional. So we need just two real numbers to parameterize in general point of corresponding homogeneous space. So for the subgroup H, we may introduce natural projection here in term of that parameterization can be given as just a map which forget the central part of the subgroup of the Heisenberg group, forget the S part, and respective right inverse map S will be a map which assign element of the group with the zero on the central part. So when we apply these two maps together to the previous diagram on the previous slide, then we obtain this group law, which in formula 20, which just look as Euclidean shift in on the plane. So nothing particularly interesting look, it look like nothing particularly interesting happened here. But we will see what there is rich structure behind a certain associated group representation. So if we will consider one parameter subgroup HX, then again to parameterize homogeneous spaces we use two real numbers corresponding to S and Y part, and the map P and S which we are using here again quite natural. So if you will just look how they are obtained, then the general approach will be as follows. You take an element SXY and you are trying to represent it in some simple form as element of the Heisenberg group times element from your subgroup, which you H, subgroup H, which you factorize. So in the first example here, which we consider it for the center, for the subgroup Z, we have elements of this form, and then the decomposition will be simply given by this expression. So you will have such a simple formula just because center commute with everything in the Heisenberg group. But decomposition for the second case, if you try to put it in the form from our subgroup X, 0, 0 here, and something simple, so probably something simple will be a purpose to get 0 in the X part here. So then you will look on the preserving component Y in this place. So this is what shall happen. And then you just use the group law on the Heisenberg group to find out what in this place it shall be S plus 1/2 of XY. So this is the decomposition. So that is from the corresponding subgroup H, and that will be our representing points for the corresponding homogeneous spaces. So this is how we obtain these P and S maps corresponding cases. And group action in this situation given by formula 21 for in the second case, which is looks a bit more tricky than it was given before. So we will try to provide all possible examples of group and subgroup corresponding homogeneous spaces, and we will see later what actually on the language of representation they produce just very few non-equivalent linear representation, although for this equivalent representation they provide very different realization. So we will get several different realization, and having several different realization for the same class of equivalent representation is very helpful in many occasions. So we will, this will be again illustrated later. Probably we will better yes, we can still have a few minutes just to see what appears with the two-dimensional continuous subgroup. So here to have two-dimensional continuous subgroup, in order to keep two-dimensionality, we have only one possibility really, as it shall be the subgroup which I call complemented to Hx, Hx prime. So we have S and Y component preserved in this subgroup and X component replaced by zero. Then for this group, again, the decomposition which we discussed before of element Sxy will be again S zero Y now in the part of the subgroup, and for the similar reasons as before, we will have zero here. No, it's not exactly what I told. We want to have simple representation just in term of one variable here, but we have to add that XY in this decomposition. So that is the maps which we have here, and action on corresponding the corresponding homogeneous one-dimensional homogeneous space will be again just a Euclidean shift. So it's look like previous formula with the Euclidean shift and formula 20 and formula 22 are rather simple, but we will obtain on the next lecture linear representation in infinite dimensional, irreducible linear representation in infinite dimensional vector spaces, which will be very far from triviality and helpful for the quantum mechanics. So that is time to finish. Any questions?